Hello, my dear students. I'm Dr. Vaishali Bharambe. I've been teaching anatomy for the last 25 years and I love it. This lecture is a part of my Central Nervous System series titled as The Anatomy of Spinal Cord Extrapyramidal System. Now, we're all always, kind of not sure of about what is this extrapyramidal system or extrapyramidal tracts to be precise. Let's understand that today. In a way that I'm confident you will remember it, I'm going to give it to you in very short, but give you the important points, okay? And that is what extrapyramidal is. You don't need to go into too many details, but you have to know that it functions and what does each tract do. The link for all the other lectures on spinal cord, there are more than 13 lectures taken. So all these links are given in the description section and all these lectures are also available on my website. Initially, they're going to be available free of cost on YouTube and website. But once you have seen them for about 2 months, I'm going to withdraw all of them and they will be available for a nominal charge from the website. Okay, let's begin. Spinal cord anatomy, extrapyramidal tracts. So just to bring you into the lecture, you're all aware that our body generates some sensory stimuli. These sensations are carried up to the brain through tracts which are called as ascending tracts. Okay, so take a look. This is your spinal cord, the brain stem, cerebral cortex and cerebellum, that side. Okay, now ascending up from the spinal cord to the cerebral cortex, carrying pain temperature is your lateral spinothalamic tract. You know it. Carrying touch pressure is your anterior spinothalamic tract. Carrying fine touch, two-point discrimination, vibration sense and so on through the medial lemniscus are the dorsal column tracts. Carrying conscious and unconscious proprioception from the head neck region is your trigeminal lemniscus. The auditory stimuli, the lateral lemniscus. Coordinating the body movements with your head and eye movements, okay, is your spinopterygial tract. And the tracts which inform the cerebellum about what is the position of the body unconsciously are the anterior and posterior spinocerebellar tract. So you saw that all these are ascending tracts through which the brain becomes aware of what is happening in the body. But question is, what is it going to do with all this information? Usko karna kya hai iske saath? What it does is, it then analyzes this sensory input and reverts through descending tracts. So now we come to the topic, descending tracts. What are the descending tracts? We are back to the same point, spinal cord below, brain stem, cerebral cortex. You are seeing a lot of other nuclei at various levels in the brain. So cerebral cortex receives information and gives rise to a tract which descends down, which as you know is called lateral corticospinal tract, corticospinal tract. There are also anterior corticospinal tracts. These are coming directly from the cortex. Very good. Now let's come down to the level of midbrain. From the red nucleus down, rubrospinal tract. From the superior colliculus nucleus down, tectospinal tract. From the vestibular nucleus down, vestibulospinal tract. And also from vestibular nucleus going up and down, limited to the cervical region and brainstem, is your medial longitudinal fasciculus. From the reticular formation down, reticulospinal tracts, right? So these are all the descending tracts, but those that come directly from the cortex are called as pyramidal tracts. And those that come from anywhere but the cerebral cortex are extrapyramidal tracts. So from the cortex pyramidal, from anywhere else in the brain, extrapyramidal. And that's the topic for today, the extrapyramidal tracts. So let's enumerate them first, okay? What are we going to study? We're going to study all these tracts, rubro, tecto, vestibulo, medial longitudinal, bundle, and reticulospinal tract In brief, I'm not going to take them in detail. I personally don't think that at an undergraduate level, you need to know so many details of the extrapyramidal tracts. Okay. However, if you do have any doubts, please feel free to call me and do my best to try and help you out in understanding them a little further. So, rubrospinal tract. Rubro means red. Okay. So, it's coming from somewhere. Either it looks red or it's called as red. That means we must bring ourselves to the red nucleus of midbrain. Somewhere they're going to be connected. Hena? Okay. So now here you are seeing a section of the spinal cord, and here in front of the lateral corticospinal is your rubrospinal tract. So you have to mentally put yourself there, spinal cord in front of lateral corticospinal tract, on both sides obviously, is your rubrospinal tract. Where does it begin? Like I told you, it begins from the red nucleus in the midbrain. So take yourself mentally there to the midbrain at the level of superior colliculus. Here you are seeing the red nucleus, right? Okay, pause. Maybe you can have some coffee or something. Just keep yourself very relaxed in CNS lectures. Tension nahi lene ka. Okay, otherwise what happens? You begin to panic, and all this, which is quite simple and elegant, just you kind of stop understanding. So bring yourself into the midbrain, bring yourself at the level of superior colliculus, and wait. Understand that your red nucleus receives information from cerebral cortex, orders from there, from thalamus, from glabrous pallidus, from cerebellum. All higher centers are informing red nucleus about something. Red nucleus is able to analyze this. Just observe opposite cerebellum, okay? So, it's able to analyze all this. And then the fibers from red nucleus come out and they cross and descend down. What do? They come out and they cross and descend down. Okay. Forming what is called as the rubrospinal tract. The crossing has got a special name, sometimes comes in MCQs. Ventral segmental decussation of 4L. Ventral segmental decussation of 4L. And it descends down as the rubrospinal tract. So now you have formed rubrospinal tract at the level of midbrain, and these tracts have started to descend down. Pons mein se jayenge, medulla mein se jayenge, and they will enter the spinal cord in front of lateral corticospinal tract as we discussed earlier. Now what does the rubrospinal do? It gives rise to connections to the anterior grey horn as seen here, which in turn stimulate neurons in the anterior grey horn to emerge out through the spinal nerve and act on muscles. What kind of action does it want? It acts in such a way that it facilitates the flexors, and inhibits the extensors. That is typically the action of rubrospinal. I'll tell you, I have known this sentence from my first MBBS years, that was very long time ago. Facilitatory to flexors, inhibitory to extensors. Rubrospinal tract. I don't want to know everything, but I have to remember how it acts. It's supposed to be an alternative pathway to the pyramidal system. It's important. Okay. So that is rubrospinal tract, from red nucleus after decussation descending down into the spinal cord, facilitatory to flexors, inhibitory to extensors. Acting under the influence of all higher centers, did you note that it was influenced by the opposite side cerebellum? And it crossed and began to act on it. Remember my sentence in my last lecture, cerebellum takes care of its own side. So cerebellum crosses and tells the red nucleus what to do, because later the red nucleus fibers are going to cross and act on the same side as the cerebellum. Bit of a complication. Think about it. It's not that difficult. Right. So we go to the next tract, tectospinal. Okay. Now for a minute, think if there is a sound, okay, or there is a sudden light, what will you do? Will you turn towards it or will you say, take care, chalta hai? Usually, if there is a sudden light, you're in the dark and there is sudden light, you automatically turn towards it. That's your tectospinal tract. Let's understand. First, as always, where is the tectospinal tract? You can see it here, students. Okay? It lies here between the anterior between the lateral vestibulospinal and the anterior corticospinal, right there in the anterior most part of your spinal cord. Now to understand how it is formed, let's go back to the midbrain. Jao wapas, go back mentally to the midbrain at the level of superior colliculus. Okay? So here you are seeing the nuclei of superior colliculi on both the sides of the midbrain. This superior colliculus, if you recall, when you were taught midbrain, seat of visual reflexes. What is it? It's the seat of visual reflexes. It receives information from retina. Whenever you see something, superior colliculus is informed. From visual cortex also it is informed. From spinal cord through from spinotectoral tract also it is informed about what's happening in the body. Inferior colliculus, that means it is informed about the sound also. From the inferior colliculus, it is getting fibers. And from the opposite side, superior colliculus. It's not like ek hi side ka information hai. It's getting information from opposite side visual centers as well. It analyzes all this. Okay, hearing, yes. Vision, yes. Spinal cord, yes. Everybody's thought process is analyzed. And it gives rise to fibers that go forward, cross and descend down. This decussation is posterior to the decussation of the nucleus and it is called as the dorsal tegmental decussation of Meynot. Again, MCQ, that's why. Otherwise, I am not very much for these names. But in this case, it does come as an MCQ for you. So, I think you should bother to remember it. And after decussation, it descends down as the tectospinal tract. So, this tectospinal tract is descending after receiving input from sensory, visual and auditory centers. Yes, sab information jaan ke niche ja raha hai. What can it do? It is responsible for audio-visual body reflex. Like I told you, if you're standing in a dark room and there is sudden light and a sound, will you think about it that there is light, there is sound, who cares? No, your body automatically turns towards it. But does the entire body turn or just only the upper part? You will see that it's only the upper part that really turns, right? And therefore, you will find also that the tectospinal tract is limited only to the upper cervical region. It doesn't go down into the thoracic region at all, okay? So that is tectospinal tract, a tract that streamlines your body actions in response to visual and sound auditory stimuli. Just put yourself on the road. You're trying to cross the road and suddenly you hear a loud horn. Okay? Do you just think, somebody is coming? No. You turn to look at it, isn't it? Immediately your body turns. Why? Because there's tectospinal tract which tells you in which direction to turn. Your eyes turn as well. It isn't like only your body turns. Your eyes turn as well to see what is the sound. Okay? All this is tectospinal tract. Right. So that's the tectospinal. Let's now go to the next tract, vestibulospinal. Pause for a minute. Have a sip of water. We're not going to hurry into this at all. Okay? Rubrospinal, facilitatory to flexors, inhibitory to extensors. One. Tectospinal, audio-visual body reflex. Vestibulospinal, what does it do? Let's take a look. Vestibulospinal lies here, okay, between the tectospinal and the olivospinal tract in the spinal cord, right there most anteriorly, okay, in the spinal cord. What does it do? Now see, whenever your body shifts position, the vestibular nuclei receive information about body position. They carry this, the vestibular ganglion in your ear carries this information to the vestibular nuclei in the pons and medulla oblongata. They will be informed that body has changed position. Parallelly, vestibular nuclei will inform cerebellum. Vestibular it will also inform the vestigial nucleus. It will not only inform cerebellum, it will also specifically inform the vestigial nucleus in the cerebellum. Parallelly, the cerebellum is also directly informed by the ear about the change in body position. What does cerebellum do? Cerebellum directly informs vestibular nuclei alter the body position to maintain balance in this and this manner. It also acts through the vestigial nucleus, giving some another advice to vestibular nucleus. Receiving all this advice, vestibular nuclei give rise to lateral vestibulospinal tract, which descends down into the spinal cord. It also gives rise to a special bundle of fibers, which are only in your brainstem and upper spinal cord region, called medial longitudinal bundle. Right. So now the vestibular spinal tract has descended down, and what action does it do? It's involved in body balance, such that it is facilitatory to extensors and inhibitory to flexors. Okay. See, whenever your extensors are in action, your body is balanced. When your flexors are in action, your body bends, isn't it? So vestibular nerve, vestibulospinal tract, is basically facilitatory to extensors and inhibitory to flexors. Got it? That's how it helps to maintain body balance. So, parallelly, I had taught you something called medial longitudinal fasciculus. Let's learn a little bit about it. Medial longitudinal fasciculus are also fibers that come from vestibular nuclei only. Okay? But they cross midline. See, vestibulospinal tract was ipsilateral, descending on its own side. Here, it crosses to the opposite side. Fibers cross and begin to ascend up and down, only in the upper cervical region, not very below, alone. Connecting the 3rd, 4th, 6th, 7th, 12th and upper cervical motor nerves to each other. This bundle is called medial longitudinal bundle. These are the cranial nerves and motor nuclei connected by the medial longitudinal bundle. But also the nucleus of lateral lemniscus. See, the hearing tract is also informed about this information. The whole function of MLB, it's commonly called MLB, medial longitudinal bundle, is maintaining equilibrium while coordinating your eye and head movements. That's the job of medial longitudinal bundle. See, your oculomotor, trochlear, related to the eye, abducens related to the eye. So you have to coordinate the actions of these along with the facial nerve and the hypoglossal nerve nuclear actions, as well as the muscles in your neck. All this is coordinated by the MLB. Somewhat, many times students find this and tectospinal tract actions somewhat overlapping. Okay, I agree that to some extent they do overlap. Right, we come to the last tract for today, reticulospinal tract, which is connecting the reticular formation of brainstem, carrying information from there into the spinal cord such that it is again facilitatory to extensors, inhibitory to flexors, helps to maintain body balance. It is important, very much important, in maintaining the muscle tone of anti-gravity muscles. Okay, all your anti-gravity muscles which are holding your body upright, their tone is maintained by reticulospinal tract. I don't want to discuss more than that. Just a little last note for all of you. Remember, in all this, cerebellum is a key person. Cerebellum, you can see here, is receiving information from spinal cord through spinocerebellar tracts. It's analyzing the unconscious proprioception information and response by giving orders to vestibular nuclei, reticular formation nuclei, red nucleus, which in turn go into the spinal cord as rubrospinal tract, reticulospinal tract and vestibulospinal tract. This is how cerebellum at all times influences these tracts to help maintain body balance as well as body balance in movement, which is when rubrospinal is acting. It is helping to maintain body balance even in that movement. So this was a lecture about the extrapyramidal tracts in brief. Okay. I believe that giving you details would make it more difficult instead of making it more easy. So that's why I've given it to you in short. Please do revise this once or twice to get comfortable with extrapyramidal tracts. These are all the other lectures taken in the spinal cord topic. Please do access the these and view them to really understand the spinal cord, I firmly believe that knowing your spinal cord is a very strong foundation needed to understand the rest of CNS. Students, do like and subscribe to my channel. Share your thoughts. My one request is, if you liked my lecture, just share it with one friend. Okay? I want to spread the word that there are these lectures, according to me, they are very good, which are available for students. In case you missed the lecture, come and watch it here. Don't miss the topic. Just if you missed a lecture, don't miss the topic. Study it here. Okay? So, all right, it was fun taking this class for all of you. I hope you enjoyed it too. I'll see you in the next lecture on spinal cord.